May the gods be with us in that magic hour. I've seen good Christians make brass decisions. Oh, she knew it, what happened to religion? Oh, she knows it. I know I'm preaching to the congregation. We love Jesus.
Yeah. How's it going, y'all? You already know who it is, and you already know what time it is, alright? You guys saw the name of this video, alright? You know exactly what's going on right now. It is episode 1 of the ranked series for this channel, and today we're starting out with a banger. I honestly couldn't think of a better time to do this ranked video, honestly. In anticipation of Donda supposedly dropping tomorrow, I'ma do Kanye West. He's the first episode of the ranked series. I mean, I don't even know where to start with this intro, because the man, like, yay, doesn't need any intro. Let's just go into the ranking, honestly. Let's do it. All right, so we're gonna start all the way down at the bottom, obviously, and we're gonna work our way all the way to number one. Also, just so you guys know, I am going to be including Cruel Summer, Watch the Throne, and also Kids See Ghosts as well. Basically, since I do consider them technically Kanye albums, even though they are a collaboration project, I still consider them technically Kanye albums, and mainly because I wanted to talk about Kids See Ghosts, but you know. We're going to start all the way down at the bottom at the number 12, which I'm sure you could have guessed is Jesus Is King. Obviously, like, I think that this is Kanye's, I guess, worst project. But even though it is, in my opinion, his worst project, I still don't consider it to be bad. I still think that Jesus Is King has some potential. It has a lot of potential when you really listen to it after a couple times. You think like, oh man, you know, if he really adapts this sound, this could sound really cool in the future. If he would just add this or that, you know. There's a lot of really interesting ideas that come out of Jesus Is King, but I don't really think a lot of the songs, at least instrumentally and production-wise, I don't really think are fully developed. There's not really much that's interesting in terms of, like, a lot of the production on it. It's pretty straightforward, very stripped back, obviously, so that Ye can, like, speak his mind on the whole thing. I just don't really go back to it, like, nearly as much as any of the other projects. Then we got, at number 11, we have Cruel Summer. I guess my biggest issue with Cruel Summer is that it just feels really bloated. Like, there's so many artists on it that I feel like it doesn't really have a specific direction, which for most collaboration projects isn't really a huge deal. Like, I know, obviously, like, Revenge of the Dreamers 3, when that came out, I loved that project. But even that project, I feel like the way that they're able to incorporate all of the features is so fluid, and it feels so natural. I feel like Ye wanted to do so much himself, and having to incorporate all of the other artists, it just felt like there were just too many ideas going in different directions for it to really be like a super cohesive collaboration project, in my opinion. At number 10, we've got the first duo project, which is Watch the Throne with Jay-Z. Watch the Throne, I guess, it's one of those interesting projects where I feel like the production hasn't really aged all that well, at least for some of the songs. I still think No Church in the Wild with Frank Ocean, I still think those tracks, and then maybe a couple others, I still think they have aged decently well, but I don't think the production has aged all that well. But even so, when you first hear it, I don't really feel like as if this is Ye and Jay-Z sort of at their peak level of creativity. I really think Kanye really takes over for a lot of the production choices on a lot of the album. Not that that's super really a bad thing, but I don't really think Jay-Z has as much of a voice on it as Ye really does. There's still some bangers that I still listen to off of it. Obviously, No Church in the Wild. Otis is a great track, obviously. Gotta Have It's pretty good too, I would say. So, I mean, yeah, you got a few tracks that I still have, you know, listened to every now and then and whatnot. At number 9, we have 808s and Heartbreaks. This album is so interesting to me because I feel like it, out of all of the Ye albums, it's the one that feels the least like a Kanye album and feels so much more just like a soothing pop album. This album basically created Drake and sort of spawned the subgenre, which is now lo-fi, basically. And so this is sort of like the early version of basically this sort of bedroom style kind of hip-hop. Obviously tracks like Heartless, Love Lockdown, RoboCop, Welcome to Heartbreak. Those are really interesting to listen to really sort of get a grasp mentally on how Kanye was sort of feeling at the time. A lot of the production is very, it's very warm and it's very soothing and almost, you know, romantic for some of the tracks. Production choices are very out of left field for what Kanye's sound really was at the time, which I really appreciate. And so at number eight, it's Ye. I think Ye is one of the best albums that talks about sort of mental disability, does it in a way that still slaps, which kind of sounds weird, but it's Kanye. Ye is really interesting because Kanye really sort of tackles his undiagnosed mental disability really head on and basically just comes straight out and says that he has bipolar disorder, and he completely 100% accepts it and even calls it his superpower. I mean, that's like the most Kanye thing that has probably like ever happened, is him using his mental disability and calling it his superpower. That's like the most Kanye thing ever. A lot of the production choices I actually really enjoy on Ye, even though they are really simple. A lot of the production is really stripped back to allow Ye to really talk about what's on his mind, just emotionally, and also what's been going on around him that has affected him and his health. Obviously, he's talking about his relationship with Kim. He talks about him wanting to kill himself, but then changing his mind because he's such an amazing artist. And so there's just a lot that's thrown around in it. I do think it is kind of messy, and I don't think it's as cohesive as it really could be. It's also a little bit shorter than I feel like it should be. I feel like if he added a couple of tracks here or there to really talk, to really grow and expand on some of the ideas that he was talking about on some of the tracks that he hints to, I feel like that would make it more interesting and it would make it more of like a full experience. At number seven, we've got The Life of Pablo. It's The Life of Pablo. Like, I mean, what more could I say about it that hasn't already really been said? It's a very controversial album for him, obviously. For the first year of its release, literally Ye kept changing little things here or there constantly on the album, even adding a full song at the end, St. Pablo. And it's just, it feels like such an incomplete album when you really listen to it. It almost has like one of the most cohesive sounds that Ye's kind of really even had, in my opinion. Like, a lot of the production, when you listen to the album all the way through, a lot of the production really fits well together. The production has really adapted well into this sort of new era of Ye sound, which is this more trap-esque sort of hip-hop sound. I still listen to a lot of the tracks off of this album usually. I usually listen to Feedback, Wolves, which is my favorite track, obviously No Parties in LA, and I guess also Famous every now and then, you know. Ultralight Beam, of course. There's just a lot of tracks on their own that just really kind of stand out on this album, even with how messy it is, in my opinion. I still think it's a pretty decent album. I still think it's pretty good, obviously. At number six, we have got Graduation. Now, with Graduation, it took me a while to really actually like the sound of this project. The tracks that I used to listen to when I first started listening to Kanye, obviously I was only exposed to like Stronger and Good Morning, which I still think are fantastic tracks, but that was sort of only scratching the surface of what this album really kind of had to offer. I really think Flashing Lights is probably my favorite track off the album, just because it has such an interesting atmosphere. The synth patterns and also just like the beat structure. It feels like a pop song, but then Ye is also rapping very nicely over it. And it's just such a, it's such an interesting vibe for the whole track, and that really carries through the entire album. Ye was really able to make a very interesting sort of pop and rap sort of cohesion for the entire album, and which I really appreciate. I still listen to Good Morning, Stronger, Flashing Lights, I Wonder. I just think it's a fantastic era time for Kanye to sort of develop into this new sound. At number five, we have got Kid See Ghosts with Kid Cudi. This whole album is just so fascinating. Like, there's so much going on in this album. So both of them were sort of looking for a recharge in their career, and this completely delivered on that. The style choices and musical choices in this album are so amazing. Just absolutely, the production on this album is crazy. A lot of the choices that Ye makes in terms of production is just so out of left field. And especially with the song Free, obviously, like, which is just basically a rock track with Kid Cudi and Ty Dolla $ign and Ye on it, just harmonizing, just singing for like the entire track, and it just goes so hard, and it's just something that you would never expect from either of them. Pretty much almost all of the tracks on this album bang. Free is definitely my favorite, but Fire is also an underrated track. Feel the Love is just absolutely insane. It just makes you want to run out into the street and start like jumping and start smashing shit. Like, that's just what it feels like. Ye's AK-47 vocals going over top of the ridiculous drum patterns is just absolutely insane. Super loud, over the top, but still fits so well with the idea of the album. At number four, we have Yeezus, and this was honestly a tough pick for me because it took me a while to really get used to the sound of Yeezus, and now I really love it. Obviously, this is like, there's so much controversy about this album as well, which is pretty much the case with most of Kanye's albums, but with Yeezus specifically, there's so much controversy about the style choices and about the production choices on this entire album. It's so grimy and it's so dark and gritty, and so much of the production is just full of electronics, a lot of synth, a lot of bass. Style choices that today would almost be like career ending for some artists if they didn't do it right. But instantly for this, it seemed like the hardcore Kanye fans really just fell in love with this, and then the mainstream Kanye fans just absolutely hated it. And so there was a real split between his fan base over this one album. I personally love it. I think I love all of the style choices on this project. Well, not all of them. There's a few musical choices, so once you get to like the latter half of the album, that I'm not a huge fan of. But I think Bound 2 is a beautiful track. It's just absolutely hilarious and so in your face, and it's a great closer to the project after the chaos from a lot of the previous songs. Bound 2 is probably like the most mellow track, and it's the closer of the album, which I think it was a great style choice. Immediately with the first track on site, you're just brought into this whole new sound, this absolutely just disgusting and gritty production choice. Daft Punk is on the production, which makes a lot of sense because a lot of it is just extremely electronic. And I absolutely love it, honestly. This was really sort of his big middle finger, obviously, to the fashion industry and a lot of the career choices when he was trying to branch out into different forms of media and entertainment and even clothing as well, and just him getting denied left and right. This was his sort of response to that, and I love that. We've gotten to the top three. We are finally here, and this is probably some of Kanye's best work that I think we will sadly might ever get. I mean, you know, we still have Donda hopefully coming sometime this weekend, maybe tomorrow, maybe even tonight, who knows. These three albums really culminate together to really make what Kanye West was at his very peak. And so we're going to start off with number three, which is Late Registration. I think Late Registration probably has some of the best production I think I've ever heard on a Kanye album. There's so much going on. There's multiple swells of strings going on. There's a lot of orchestration, which you never even really heard at the time of this album's release. It was definitely something that was very grand, very cinematic for the whole project, and which I absolutely adore the sound of this whole project. It really sounds like you're listening to a movie soundtrack with how beautiful everything just culminates together. Tracks like Gold Digger, Roses, which is a super emotional song about the death of his grandma, Diamonds for Sierra Leone, absolutely gorgeous tracks all the way through this thing. And it really gives you sort of a little bit more of an insight into his personal life than we really got off of College Dropout, which I also appreciated as well. And so all of that mixing together just makes this like one of the best Kanye albums just as a whole that you could really experience. Now we've got at number two, which is either gonna make a lot of people really pissed off or it's gonna make some of you happy. But either way, I don't really care because this is my list, so. At number two, we have got, yes, it is My Beautiful Dark Twisted Fantasy. All right, you know, I could go on and on about like the production and style choices on this. Production is just absolutely bonkers on like this whole fucking thing. Obviously, like you guys all know that. I know that without a doubt. You guys know it, okay? The main thing that really kind of holds me back a little bit is some of it just doesn't work for me, really. And some of the features on it, I feel like are either underused or I feel like they just kind of take over the whole track, which is sort of what he meant to do. That's just for like maybe a few moments here or there. I still think this album is absolutely incredible. If I was to rate it, I'd probably give it like a 9.5. Honestly, I think Twisted Fantasy is just absolutely an incredible project, and it's just such a great musical feat for what it was at the time that it came out. It's already a classic now, and it will be a classic for pretty much the rest of time, I really think. And my number one, you guessed it, it's the fucking College Dropout. Let's go, boys. Okay, so there's so much that I could say about the College Dropout, but I guess I'll start with why I chose it as my number one. It's probably the one Kanye album that I really resonate with the most, just because he likes to talk about his struggle with trying to come up, having troubles in schooling, having troubles in his life, and like it feels like it's his most honest self, and that's really what we got for like the whole project. Production on this is just absolutely fantastic. At each and every song, all the production choices really meld together really well. No song ever sounds the same. Every song has a different beat structure. Ye's lyricism is just absolutely amazing throughout this whole project. It's very braggadocious, but it's also very like sweet at times, and it's very emotional. There's other times where it's just like so in your face that you just want to get up and you just want to jam to it. And then there's other times where he's just sort of speaking to you personally, and he's not even rapping. He's literally talking to you, especially with the last track, Last Call. He's just talking to you, you know, over this very nice production and this very nice beat. That's like the entire last 12 minutes. There's so much going on, and there's so much that is said throughout like the whole project. And I could listen to this whole album on repeat for like the rest of my life. I just absolutely love it so much. I listen to it pretty much religiously, and it's my favorite Kanye album. I mean, it's just absolutely my favorite Kanye album. There's not really much bad I can say about it, to be honest. I mean, there's not really much I don't like about it. There's maybe like a few tracks here or there that I don't really return to like as much as say like Spaceship or We Don't Care or Never Let Me Down or All Falls Down, which I think is one of the best rap songs of all time. You can fight me in the comments section on that. If you don't think All Falls Down is one of the best rap songs of all time, you can fight me in the comments on that, because I absolutely 100% think it is. There's just so much said in that one song, and it just all melds together. All of his verses and the chorus all meld together so well, and it's such a great song. And I just think that it's just absolutely beautiful. And the album in general is just absolutely beautiful. I really wish that I wasn't 4 years old when it came out, because I absolutely would have been bumping this shit in the early 2000s if I would have known about it. I love it. And that's my number one. And that's pretty much my entire list, guys. So we made it. That's my Kanye ranked list. Definitely appreciate you guys watching. I know this is going to be a long video for you guys. And so I appreciate you guys taking the time to actually watch all the way through if you did. And yeah, honestly, there's nothing more that I could really ask for. I know this is going to be a very interesting weekend. Whether or not Donda comes out or not, you guys already know I'm going to be giving you that reaction as soon as it comes out for you guys. And yeah, I don't know. I feel like this was just such a timely thing to do since, you know, Ye is coming out with a new album. Figured I'd get my Kanye ranked out there for you guys to, you know, experience, for you guys to really criticize. If you have anything that you agree with or disagree with, I'm totally open to discussion. If you guys want to bring up different opinions, or maybe something that I didn't talk about for a specific album that you really think I should have, I'll be happy to address that. That's all my Kanye albums ranked. Thank you guys for watching. I definitely appreciate this. It's gonna take me a while to edit this, so you may either be seeing this Thursday night or maybe Friday. I don't know yet. I'll see what happens. Be sure to like and subscribe down below. Hit that notification button so you guys can check out my Donda review, if it even comes out. Who knows? But hey, at least if you have notifications on and I end up doing a review and it ends up coming out, then you guys will know. I really hope Kanye gets the help that he needs to become more stable, and so that he can be a great father, and so that he can also be a great husband to Kim. And I just, you know, I just want the best for Kanye. I love the dude, obviously. You know, I'm absolutely a huge fan. And I just want everything to go well for him, you know. I 100% support him, and I just hope he's okay. Honestly, that's just all I can hope for, and that's all any of us can hope for. Hopefully I will see you guys sometime this weekend. And yeah, thank you guys for watching, and I'll see y'all in the next video.